Do my USB sockets use power all the time? And how do I know they're working correctly? This looks like one for you, Gordon. With the table set up like this, I'd like to introduce Gordon Routledge to tell us what's going on.
You best put your glasses on, Gary. Could get technical, but hopefully not too technical. We've done a lot of videos recently about USB charging sockets, and it's a bit of a, divides electricians down the middle. Customers love them. Yeah. A lot of electricians don't like them. And one of the reasons people say they don't like them is because they think when they're not actually being used to charge, they're consuming lots of power.
It sure is. That's the myth, isn't it? When they're in this state here with nothing plugged in, they're actually still using power.
Yeah, but hopefully we're just going to prove that that's not the case.
Right.
So, USB sockets are covered by the European Ecodesign regulations. I'm sure you've read them all. There's lots of them. Joe covered one described as Lot 20.
He did, yeah.
In a video to do with electric heating. External power supplies come under Lot 7.
Right, okay.
And what that specifically says when it comes to a power supply is when it's not being used or when it's in an unloaded condition,
right,
it mustn't consume more than 0.3 watts of power.
Right, okay. So we've got four USB chargers there, one in each of the actual outlets. So that's 1.2 watts as a maximum load.
Yeah, that's it. So yeah,
in idle.
Yeah, even though there's two sockets here, that's classed as one charger.
Yes.
So let's just have a look. We've got our Hamig power meter here, which I'd suggest is now working at the very bottom of its range.
Yes.
If you plug that in, Gary, if you bring the camera in, let's have a little.
Let's have a little look
at what's going on.
Right. Okay.
So see, this is our line voltage coming in. So bang on 230 volts. Current almost nothing, and this is the power here. It's sort of dancing around at just less than 1 watt.
So that's suggesting that these four USB socket outlets that aren't in use are only using about 1 watt of electricity.
Yeah, so what I'll do now, I'll connect up. We've got a tablet here that's waiting to charge. I've got these USB-C testers. So we use quite a lot of these. I mean, there's quite a few testers on the market. You can get professional ones. We picked up these from a well-known online retailer. With free delivery, Gary.
Okay, so would that be Amazon?
Yeah, it can be Amazon. And there's lots of versions out there of these. We picked this version because it's sort of encased.
Right.
There's a lot of open PCB versions in there, and we just think there'll be bits get in there and short the circuit out. So, plug in this panel here. So you'll see, we showed this in a previous video. I've plugged into the USB-C outlet here. The tablet won't charge off this socket.
Okay, so that's got no power for that. And if we go over here, we're exactly the same position we were before with it just flicking around a little bit. So no power beyond the less than 1 watt being consumed.
Yeah, so that's because that needs quite a bit of power. So I'm going to plug into this power delivery socket that we had last time. And we'll see that'll power up.
Ah, yeah, I've heard the beep.
Bleep on the iPad, and it's automatically gone up to 15 volts. It's drawing 0.4 of an amp, so that's about, hold on, still getting there.
Okay, they're communicating between the two to settle itself in.
Yeah, so that's that's flipping around about 8 watts, it should be.
Okay, so if we go back over here then, yeah, that's dead right. Yeah, we're flipping around a little bit, 7 to 8 watts as it settles into that charging process.
So there will be some losses in the power supply in there, but you can see as we load them up, they do kick into action and start supplying power to our devices.
Okay, so there's the first myth then. So, strictly speaking, they do use a little bit of power, but under Lot 7, we know that can't be above
0.3 of a watts
per unit. Mm. Okay, and this one was less than that, wasn't it? It was slightly less than that. So, a tiny bit of power. They're not effectively on all the time, which is the myth, isn't it, Gordon?
Yeah, and that applies for whether the charger's built into a socket or is one of those little block type ones that won't be coming soon with your mobile phone in the future because they're trying to stop that happening.
That's for e-waste, and we covered that in a previous video as well. So that's the first thing then. So I'm a bit concerned because you seem to have maybe dismantled one or two of these USB charging ports. So let's go back and see that process as you hack it to bits. I see you're in with your drill first as you're taking out the rivets in order to expose what I would call the farmyard behind it. In other words, these PCB boards. So you're drilling them out. I take your screwdriver to it in order to remove all the screws. I've speeded it up slightly, so we're not going to see Gordon take out all the screws. So he's going to pop those out, and then he's going to reveal underneath. Gently does it, Gordon. We don't want to lose anything out of there. Here we go, is all the special components, which I'm going to let you tell us all about.
Okay.
Generous man I am.
Yeah, so again, USB sockets, when they first came out of the market, got quite a bad press. And then someone flagged up in one of our other videos a report by the Electrical Safety Council, which was about 4 years old. Since then, BS 1363 has been updated numerous times to include these charging sockets. So we'll probably have a closer look, Gav. If you bring the camera in, we'll have a closer look at some of the things that relate back to that regulation.
Okay, yeah, I'm a little nervous as I come in.
So here's our unit with the front off. So there's the shutter you'd expect to see on the socket.
Yeah.
A regular 13 amp socket. I'll just throw that away.
Okay, no longer needed. Yeah,
I'm doing that. So cleverly, really, how they've squeezed in essentially what is a 20 watt power supply in amongst all the other workings that the socket has to do. So there's our double pole switch here. You know, and here's our two USB socket outlets that keep them far apart, which I'm, you know, some units are very close together.
Okay, is there any concerns? Because obviously these are differing voltages, Gordon.
Yeah, so that is a lot of the safety requirements. So I guess the first thing you'll see in 1363 is this charging element, which is here. So this is a switch mode power supply that obviously converts our line voltage down to the low voltage required for the USB ports.
Right.
Mustn't rely upon the circuit fuse for the ring final circuit this is probably connected to.
Right, okay, so let's clarify that one for me. Let's flip myself back in. That makes logical sense, doesn't it? It might be a 32 amp circuit breaker in the consumer unit or distribution board feeding the socket outlets, and we can't rely on if there's a fault in the charging lead part of the circuit, so from the USB out of that 32 amp fuse disconnecting. That makes logical sense. What do we rely on?
So we rely on a fuse. And there's got to be a fuse either in the line conductor that feeds the charging socket or on the circuit board itself.
Okay.
So I took a, it's quite good that the camera we use is better than our eyes. I took a photograph of that just so we'll see it first and then we'll have a look at it.
I've just brought it in, Gordon, and there it is, clearly identified. Can you just remind me of its ampere rating?
So that's a T3.15 amp fuse at 250 volts. So the T is a time delay, so that's just to allow for any surge that might happen. Okay. In the circuit.
So when you're sort of plugging it in and out, you get
and more
initial
surge? When the initial surge, when the power supply starts. Okay, inrush current, should we say.
Yeah, I like that, that's better. Yeah. So there is a fuse in it. So when we said that maybe if the charging unit wasn't working maybe correctly or at all, I'm sure the first thing is we'll think about the lead when we go into the device, and you probably the customer or the consumer would be running around trying to find another lead, but it can be that the fuse is obviously operating within that.
Let's have a look. Let's bring that camera back in and we'll see the fuse in where it sits in there. So you can see it tucked away in there.
Just point it again, just there at the back. Yeah.
And then you'll notice there's a lot of plastic around us designed to isolate the low voltage side from the mains voltage side. So you'll see the cables that go out towards the USB sockets. You know, they have two layers of insulation.
Okay, yeah, brilliant.
So even if one layer fails, you've still got another layer. So there's no real chance of the mains voltage appearing on the USB-C socket, the USB-A socket in that one, sorry.
Okay, yeah.
And that's what a lot of safety reports worry about. It's this isolation of the primary side. And again, we can see it on this, on the switch mode power supply here.
Is that a board dividing it there? Is that green thing a divider
as
well?
Yeah, that's part of it. But again, if I swap that and come in close on this one, again, you'll see there's a there's a big, nice clear gap on the, this is the mains voltage side of the charger.
Yeah.
Here's the low voltage side. So you've got that clear divider there.
Yeah.
Extra insulator. You'll notice all the wires that go out to the secondary side, again, have two layers of insulation.
And that makes logical sense. You don't want 230 volts appearing in your USB A or C outlet point.
Yeah, so when you hear sort of safety complaints about these things, it is normally something to do with this isolation between primary and secondary.
Okay.
So, you know, I would say that this is a great bit of engineering. These are Hamilton ones were featured in that earlier video.
Yeah.
They've done a good job on fitting that in there.
Yeah, because of the space they've got, okay, obviously, and then they've got a subdivide, the 230 volts from this reduced voltage for our USB charging port. Yeah, really good. So a lot of technology in a very small place, but remember there is a fuse in there. So if it does fail, it could be that that fuse has obviously expired in life. Where would you like to go next, Gordon?
Yeah, and again, just back to these little testers that we clients have been using a lot in the videos. That obviously we're seeing now that USB chargers are getting a lot more advanced.
Yeah.
And let's remember that it's often the device that determines how much charge is taken.
And we call that the communication, don't we?
Yeah, in partnership with the power supply, should we say. So you plug in a device and they basically talk to each other to say, how much have you got for me and how much do they need? Obviously, the device will never draw more current than the charger can provide.
And can we show that perhaps if I'll bring Handcam in and perhaps we plug the lead into Handcam and we'll see how much power
that we can see some various charging modes.
Let's try and make Handcam work twice.
So let's plug it in on a USB socket. So if you plug
that into there.
Yeah. All right. Okay. So again, another one of these little plug-in charger devices. They are there's loads of these.
Okay.
So we'll go into the USB type A socket there.
Okay, yeah. You'll be able to talk me through the power.
So what we can see there is the voltage that's coming out of the socket, the current that's currently being drawn by the phone.
Yep.
So that's near to the 2.4 amps this socket can supply. But the phone's, you know, depends on, again, it's the phone that decides that, and to a degree the cable.
Yeah.
But we can see there, and it also, if you plug this in for a while, it records the milliamp hours.
Oh, right,
so
okay.
Obviously you can see how much capacity of charge has gone into a battery, if you wanted to look at that. So that's on this one. This, we looked in the previous video, there's various protocols for USB now. You can get ones that do it on quick charge.
Right.
Which if we flip to this socket, this USB-A socket underneath this has
Right, okay. So as this phone can accommodate a quick charge, you're telling me this will punch a bit more into it, will it?
Yeah, so what we should see here is that initially 5 volts, then it should leap up to a higher voltage and be able to deliver significantly more power to the phone.
Okay.
So again, plugging in our little tester.
Look.
Let's boot it up.
So the communication going on now. And we'll see that power kick in.
It's 5 volts, 2 amps.
Yep.
Well, let's try on the USB-C.
Okay, we're in.
Yeah, so I'm going on.
Let's have a look now.
This one here, so it started at 5 volts, about 1 amp.
We expect it to kick up, do we?
Yeah, so there we go. So the voltage has now leapt up to 9 volts, yeah, about 1.2 amps.
And that will obviously charge the phone considerably faster.
Yeah.
Right, okay, that's a good point to prove. Let's pull back out again. Okay, so yeah, and that proved it, didn't it? So if somebody comes to you know, got a certain style of socket outlet and they believe after perhaps using this one in the past, and if this isn't coming now in your iPhone box because of e-waste, they're not sending these out anymore, and you're using the USB, and you're probably gonna hear from the customer, it's taking forever to charge.
Yeah.
So when you come round as the electrical contractor, if you just plug one of those sticks in that we got from Amazon.
Amazon, yeah, there's lots of them on there. We will put the link for these ones in the description below.
Yeah.
They are very reasonably priced. We don't, we often say, we often try and convince people to buy a better quality of tool.
That's right down the low end.
Yeah, these are pretty cheap. And the reason we'd say, you know, I'm not say quite disposable, but technology changes all the time. These are pretty handy to have in the toolbox if you're fitting a lot of these all the time, and if your customer's likely to say, things aren't charging as they once were.
Well, yeah, and because these are usually fast charge, and when you're over to them, it's about probably now for the electrical contractor selecting the right outlet to obviously manage the expectation of the charging process with the client, isn't it? And we do like the ones in the module there, so that's the Euro module style that we've just gone in there, because they are dedicated and usually provide faster charging.
Yeah, and this will go up to 45 watts, and yeah, I can even charge my laptop off one of those. Not at really fast speed, but it's enough to keep it charged when you're working on it.
There's lots changing in this field. We know that we're probably moving away from USB-A over a period of time to USB-C. We'd love your comments below. What's your go-to socket outlet when you're looking at charging devices, whether they be Apple or Samsung? Please leave those comments below and we'll try and get back to as many as we can.